for the last 4 years at Axiom, the last 4 months as CEO, you know, it's been my dream since I was like 3 years old. When I say dream, it's all I've been thinking about. And as we as a company have now sent multiple countries, multiple missions, 16 astronauts to the ISS, and I figured out how to go, I realized that my purpose is much more about getting as many people up as we possibly can, because I am certain that we will have many opportunities to go.
So do you think you will in your lifetime?
Yeah, for sure.
And how many years?
Sure. You know, possibly this decade, definitely next decade.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Before that, though, the orbital data center.
Yes.
Can you explain what exactly this is? Because we talk a lot about data centers here, but we never talk about them in the orbital context.
In layman's terms.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. So it's interesting. Like, I'm smiling now because I'm just thinking about going to space. You know, while my first passion has always been space, actually the one thing I'm probably another expert on in the world is cloud. You know, before getting into space, I had my own startups. I worked at ESPN in the early days of HD streaming. And I was at Google on the startup side while we were ramping up Google Cloud. And as we know, on the terrestrial side, cloud is a phenomenal business, right? It's a phenomenal business model. The market's growing faster than the largest cloud providers combined. We believe space is going to be exactly the same thing from a business model standpoint. But then the question is, why send a data center up there when we have so many down here? And the first thing I would say is, think of it this way. When we're talking about orbital data centers, and we've been running cloud computing on the International Space Station, Axiom Space, along with Amazon, since our AX-1
mission. Yeah, the Snowcone Edge computer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And on every single mission, we've done significant compute on it. And between missions, we've done workloads from the ground. On the AX-4 mission, we sent up an Aura ring that was checking the biometrics of the astronauts. I'm going to go, oh, yeah. Are you give me the finger?
You know, wearing one right now.
I love it. I'm obsessed. You are
looking at the ring.
Yeah. I got it the first day I took the CEO role. And I got it to track my stress.
So it was like bestowed upon you?
sort of.
Okay.
I think the metric that I care the most about is sleep. That's the one I track in terms of my performance. But we were measuring all these things on the AX-4 mission and feeding it to the snow cone on ISS. So actually using edge compute, cloud compute in space versus on the ground. But the point here is, when you think about orbital data centers in the ISS, don't think of them as so far away. It's literally 250 miles away.
So how much power does it take?
A lot.
So okay, what's a lot?
It's the same problem that we're gonna have here on Earth, which is also interesting to me now with AI, that the limiting factor is power. And you're seeing this growth for nuclear startups, and you're seeing this growth for AI data centers needing nuclear power. When we're talking about space, that's going to be the limiting factor.
So is that the answer? Nuclear, small modular reactors? How do you power these
things? I think
so.
It's a little...
Is there any other way to do it? Could you do it with solar?
You could, but at some point, those are going to get so big to give the power we need. And a lot of people will say, and I'm not speaking as a scientist here, because I said the wrong thing first also, which is, well, you don't have to worry about cooling there. You do. You have to, convection is something that is, you know, you have to, for all the power you create, you have to dissipate it as well. So that just surface area is going to get so large. So I think ultimately that will be the same solution. But the point about the orbital data centers is, for many people on the Earth, not like us here in New York or in Virginia or DC or other cities, that will be the closest data center to someone at any given time.
Wow.
So how concentrated is this space? How many players are here alongside you all?
So we, as Axiom, we're building the replacement to the International Space Station, and our modules that will connect to the ISS due to our exclusive contract to connect a commercial module, those are cloud first. To keep human life going, you need cloud computing services. Now, we could fractionalize those and offer those to other companies. We're actually sending up separate infrastructure later this year. You had asked when, Q4,
okay,
in the next couple of months. But the point of this network, ours we call a heterogeneous network. A module could be a data center, a satellite could be a data center. But when you look at other constellations, those are homogeneous networks, all the same, but the point is they're connected by data. Some are all one network, some are federated, but this is where we're going. You know, in terms of where the space is, I think people are finally starting to wake up. Just even the fact that you're talking about orbital data center, ODCs as we call them, just 6 months ago, people wouldn't know what you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
The words are very obvious, a data center that's orbiting the Earth. But still, it's just kind of like, why? But I think we've gone well past that, and now it's how and when.
You said that the potential use case here is that some people who live around the world, this might be the closest data center to them at any given moment, one that does orbit. But there are latency issues with that and speed of connectivity issues that I would imagine are better handled on the ground by wireline connections.
So I love that question. I would have had the same thing. When my team came to me, and they gave me all the reasons why we should do this. And again, I'm a cloud not and a space not. I was looking for solutions for that.
Like, this is the literal cloud.
Yeah, literal. This is literally literal cloud above the clouds, right? Like, not data centers around here. One of the most powerful use cases of orbital data centers is low latency AI. So it actually solves the AI, the latency problem for many distance issues like cars. Driving around in remote areas, navigation for maritime needs. Now, there's many cases of that for Earth, but now when you just go a little bit above the atmosphere and look at space, edge computing on labs in space, edge computing for other satellites. Where it gets really crazy and awesome for me is what happens when latency actually becomes a problem because of distance. So we have laser and optical communication. I'm not worried about speed and bandwidth. I am worried about power. But what happens when your distance is so long that actually synchronizing the internet is a problem? Or when two planets are on opposite sides of the sun? You don't even have line of sight. How are we going to synchronize Twitter? How are we going to synchronize YouTube? How are we going to FaceTime? I think those are just such cool problems for students around the world to solve.
So super quickly, the ISS is set to retire by the end of 2030. How confident are you in that timeline? And what risks does Axiom face if NASA extends its life longer than expected?
Yeah, I'm pretty confident it will come down. It's already been extended, right? Originally, I think the expiration date was 2024, and Congress has stretched it out. It's a piece of equipment, right? It was designed with a certain lifespan. Some parts are newer than others, but the whole thing was designed to come down as one. So I think it's a given. It will come down. When we'll see, but I think by 2030. I feel very confident about it. I don't think there's any risk if the government extends it. I think it's great if they extend it. But independent of that, if there isn't a commercial solution, if Axiom Space is not up and running by the time it comes down, the only other space station in operation is the Chinese station. Right. So that is a very real, I'll say competitive threat, strategic competitive threat. And from a diplomatic standpoint, the leadership that the U.S. has provided, and now the leadership that companies like Axiom Space, the diplomatic interests we can push for the U.S. around the world with all the different countries, we'll basically just be ceding that to the Chinese. And I don't think that's what we want.